Hello, very good evening and welcome to this special edition of our Thursday evening programme on Sheffield Live TV. Sometimes you only need the one guest to fill a studio. He's one of the best, certainly in my 40 odd years of having the pleasure of covering football in this part of the world. He is right up there. Needs no introduction. So, hello, Dave Bassett. Good to see you.
Yeah, good to see you, Alan. Yeah, it was good to come up to Sheffield and brought some good memories driving up. I did it for long enough and through the countryside and everything else. It brought back a lot of good thoughts. So, nice.
You were almost commuted at one time. You were up and down that motorway like Bilio, weren't you?
Well, the first period when I joined in January, till the summer when my wife and daughters came up, I was up and down there. I was up most of the week. I used to come up and I've got to say, you know, the first 6 weeks it was snow up here. I couldn't believe it. I'm travelling all the way out from London on the motorway. There's no snow. Turn left at Junction 29 and all of a sudden it was like being in the Arctic.
Yeah. Well, it hasn't changed. You'll know that from your return visits. This is a fleeting one, but I know that in common with other players and managers, that once you came to Sheffield, as you did with Sheffield United, by the way, for anybody who doesn't know, we'll recap Dave's career shortly. After you left Sheffield United, you stayed here for a number of years, didn't you?
Yeah, 16-odd years. I went to Crystal Palace for a period, and then I went to Forest, and then Barnsley, and Leicester, you know, so I lived here until, when I was 60, I decided to move south because my wife's dad had had a stroke and there was no way they could come up, and she felt, as I was travelling to Leicester, you know, we'd do it the other way around. So, but no, 16 odd years Sheffield was a good home. I thoroughly enjoyed it.
Yeah, there's something about the city for people like yourself, Chris Waddle, Carlton Palmer for a number of years, any number of people around your era who kind of came to Sheffield and probably thought the worst of it in some instances, saw how leafy the southwest of the city was and how lovely, and just stayed.
Yeah, I must confess, I didn't know where Dore and these places were. My side of Sheffield was travelling past Rotherham on the M1, and it didn't look particularly enticing, to be quite honest. I didn't mention that to the wife, but of course it's a beautiful countryside, and as I say, it's a good city. It's lively. I mean, people like Brian Gale, Simon Tracy, John Gannon, Frenchie, they've all stayed in Sheffield since they came up from London, and quite a few other people. Pemberton as well was another one.
Emlyn Hughes did after he became Rotherham manager too. Was it a hard sell to Mrs. Bassett then when you said to her, well, I'm thinking of going to Sheffield United?
Well, I'd been sacked by Watford and I wanted to get him to work, and the Sheffield United job was being offered, and it was a big club, it was a move, and I wanted to move away from London, really. I wanted a different challenge completely. I didn't know much about Sheffield, but I said, we've got to go, I've got to work, and we get on with it. And the wife, and she was perfectly all right. Yeah, okay, if we've got to do it, then let's get going, and we'll see how we go. I signed for 18 months and I wasn't sure how long that was going to last, and ended up nearly, 16 and a half years.
Yeah, well, in the city, and sort of 7-8 years in the job, six and a half years, I think.
It was 7 years, 11 months I was at Sheffield United, from the January 88 to leaving in December 95. So I didn't quite make the eight, but, as I say, it was a great period in my life in Sheffield. Not the first sort of 6 months, it was difficult coming to terms and seeing and getting used to the place, and then sort of getting relegated in that first period was a disappointment, but it was an opportunity to start all over again, and we got it going, and it was a new period where new players come in, there was a lot of old players that went and contracts were out, so it was a good opportunity to rebuild, and fortunately we did it quite successfully to get promotion.
And the rest, as they say, is history. Dave is a manager of 7 promotions, over 1,000 games as a manager. This is for people who've just sort of woken up, either that or they're a bit younger than you.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's
younger than me. 4 promotions at Wimbledon, a miraculous achievement there, taking them from the basement to the big time. 2 promotions at Sheffield United. 4 years you survived with the club in the Premier League.
That's right.
A couple of playoff finals to add to that. One was at Crystal Palace, another was locally at Barnsley, and a promotion at Nottingham Forest.
That's right.
I mean, that's some kind of career that you've had, and we're going to relive some of those times, in particular the famous promotion day at Leicester. We've got some video of that, yeah, some dressing room video, and look back on that. But as you look back on that, how hard has it been to let go? I mean, you haven't been sort of working permanently in football since a job as assistant manager at Leeds, I think.
That's correct, yes.
2008 with Dennis White.
Right, that's right.
So, I mean, that's 11 years. How's that transition been?
It's been quite hard, but at the same time, I was ready for it. I was ready for a bit of a rest. I was offered some jobs in the sort of League One, League Two situation, but they wanted the miracles of Sheffield United and Wimbledon, and they didn't have the facilities or the backup, and the game had changed sufficiently, and they didn't appeal to me. So, you know, I had a bit of good time where we travelled abroad, and I did some media work and that type of thing.
You were on Sky for many years, weren't you?
Well,
as a pundit on Sky.
Excuse me.
Yeah, me too. I was catching. We both got heavy colds. You would never have been able to tell it's midwinter in Sheffield.
No, as I say, Sky were very good to me, so I was getting Sky work, and that was good. And had the right job come along, I would have taken it. Possibly, when I look back now, I probably should have looked around and said and found another job that suited me for a few more years. But as I say, time goes on. I enjoyed myself. As I say, I had a long time doing it, 1,000 games. It was full on as manager. It's not like being a head coach now where you just look after the team. At Sheffield United, I was responsible for dealing with contracts, agents, everything, you know, in terms of that, and also sort of the commercial aspects with, you know, Andy Dakin cooperating and all that. Yeah. So, but it was great. It was a wonderful experience being at Sheffield United. I mean, it got a bit nitty gritty at the end when we had problems in Sheffield United in the boardroom with Reg Brearley, you know, in a situation where he wanted a sell and he couldn't get it sold, and then he introduced Sam Hashimi, who we weren't quite sure whether he was a man or was a woman. He's used to change that from time to time, and that was to sort of flush Paul Woolhouse out, and Paul had his heart in the right place, but unfortunately his businesses went up the creek, and Reg came back and still wanted a sell. So it was a very unstable period. We didn't have any money at all, you know, really in that time. I mean, in my time at Sheffield United, with what we achieved, I made a £5 million profit. So it didn't cost the club any money for all the players we bought. What I sold and got in was 5,000 profit. Just imagine.
£5 million profit.
£5 million profit. Yeah. Just imagine what that would be in this day and age. So we had to cut our cloth accordingly. I was happy with that. I knew that was the club's situation. That's where they were. So I got on with it. We was never in a position when we was in the Premier League to ever compete with any of the top boys. We was always realistically going to be down the bottom, which we always were in the first half of all the seasons, because we didn't have the money to go and pay the extra money for the players that would have enhanced the team.
But when you did, I mean, obviously you signed Vinnie Jones at one stage, but the other real high profile signing I remember was Brian Gale for, I think, a quoted £700,000, which was a lot of money for Sheffield United.
Oh, yeah, it was, yeah.
Centre half. Who'd served you well at Wimbledon. And I remember the delay to that being completed. I mean, it was virtually out in the press and everywhere that it had been done, and yet it hadn't been done.
No, that's right.
And the reason being that Sheffield United were short of the...
Yes, there have been problems with cash, etc. And Paul Woolhouse was talking to me about it, and I'd got Brian Gale, it had all been done, and he said, we're 100,000 short, you know.
Right.
Do you know anybody or anything, or would you be prepared to help us out? You know, I'll make sure you get your money back. You know, we got money coming in from the Premier League, etc. And I didn't want to feel that, you know, all of a sudden I was going to scupper the deal. I thought it was right for the club. He was the right type to be the captain. So I managed to have some money, 50 grand, and I got 50 grand mortgage on my property and lent it to the club. And true to his word, Paul Woolhouse paid me back about a year later,
So you forked up 100,000 effectively, 50 of which was borrowed, to push through that deal.
Yeah.
And you hadn't got the 100, but you got 50.
50, yeah, that's right. Yeah, my accountant remembers it, where I just rang him up and said, I need 50 grand, can you speak to the bank? And he did that. And, you know, I got some savings that I had, and I cashed that in and, you know, gave it to him. You know, I believed in the club. I trusted them. There were people there. I didn't think for one moment that the club would shaft me.
Right. What did Mrs. Bassett say when you did, or did you tell her?
I don't think I told her straight away, but I sort of filtered it in at some stage. She wasn't completely impressed. She didn't think that I should have done it, but I did it, and it all worked out okay. So it was one of those events, and I didn't want to let Brian down because he was there, and we needed him. We needed him at that time. So had I said no and we couldn't find anybody, Brian wouldn't have come, which would have been a disappointment for him and me. Mm. And who knows, it might have affected the team as well.
Can you imagine any Premier League manager now, you know, having to or being willing to, you know, pay out of their own pocket for a...
Well, I don't think they have now, but I'm not even sure anybody else in the past had done it as well. I don't know of anybody, you know, there may have been somebody who contributed to the club. I mean, in actual fact, you know, I put 25 grand into Wimbledon with Sam at one stage. I needn't have done it. Well, I shouldn't have done it. Sam was testing me to see, about my loyalty to Wimbledon. And I think also he was quite clever that he knew I wasn't going to leave if I was owed 25 grand. But again, you know, he paid it back, and it was something I did. Probably a lot of people said to me, you know, it's not advisable, you shouldn't, it's volatile. But sometimes you do things and you think you do it for the right reasons. And in these instances, I don't regret it because, as I say, it served a purpose. And at the same time, both Wimbledon and Sheffield United were honourable and repaid the loans.
Everybody was happy. We're going to relive part of the Leicester experience shortly. In fact, in both parts of this interview, we'll have a flavour of that. But meantime, we need to come up to date with Bramall Lane. In fact, you and I parked there today.
That's
and that
great.
Was a visit down memory lane for you, pulling your car into your car park, because I felt fairly sure that you'd know how to get there, whereas this studio's a bit tucked away, you know.
Yeah, and I was still naughty. I still come in the no entry sign like I used to do in those days, and the steward used to get the hump with me, but quite naturally. And it was good to see. I've been back to Bramall Lane. It's very fond memories. I had some wonderful days there and times there and real good fun. So, yeah, I always enjoy coming back from Sheffield. You know, I always feel at home.
And you refer to the £5 million profit that you made while transporting Sheffield United into the top flight from two divisions below. Somewhat different to today, but again, the club, as in your era, is, I suppose, looking from outside, many people would say, is overachieving fantastically at the moment.
Yeah, they're doing extremely well. I mean, Sheffield United and Norwich and the teams that come up are always expected to be down the bottom, and generally they are, and sometimes one or two of them get relegated either in the first season or the second season. But Sheffield United have acquitted themselves extremely well and done well. They've added to the team, and again, the game is different with the Premier League. There is money available, which Chris was able to utilise to bring some players in that he wanted to, and that's understandable. He's got support. Norwich have taken a different view on it, that they're not going to do that. Well, Sheffield United have done the right thing, in my opinion. They've given Chris some support because of the squad, and I dare say possibly they may also push a bit more out at the next transfer window if he feels he needs a player in that's going to help. So, but having said that, you know, since Chris has come there, he's got two automatic promotions on the trot, which is extremely good, and he's acquitting himself well, and he's building a good reputation for himself. And as I say, I'm hoping, I'm the only Sheffield United manager to stay more than a year in the Premier League. So I'm hoping that Chris can stay this year, then at least he's got a second year as well at it.
Yeah, absolutely. But if he does the 4 years like you, he'll have gone some, I would say.
Well, I did 4 years in the top level, but it wasn't the Premier League, because the Premier League was 1992, wasn't it?
It was still the top flight.
Oh, yeah, it's still the top flight. Yeah, I understand that. But, I mean, as far as the Premier League are concerned, you know, we did only 1 year in the Premier League. Yeah, thing happens is that, you know, since the Premier League started with Sky, I can understand it. Everybody thinks football started from that day and was reinvented. Mm. But there was a lot more that went on before there, but that's the way of life.
Well, Chris was able to spend £40 million last summer, relatively a lot of money for Sheffield United, and certainly looking at your era. But he went a particular way with it, because £40 million ain't a lot of money, is it, these days, in terms of the top flight. But he's got players for development, and one or two are really showing exactly why.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, £40 million is a lot of money, but when you think that, you know, Spurs or Man City or Man United have spent more than that on one player, as such, he's utilised it well. He's known what he's wanted to do. But what he's done is he's given the boys that have been around for the last 2 years that have done extremely well for him and not let him down. He's given them their head, and one's got to say that most of them are taking the opportunity. I mean, obviously, Henderson keeping him was good. Obviously, that will have to be looked at in the future unless Manchester United decide they want to sell. But then again, you know, the back three have stayed. The wing-backs have been there. Fleck in midfield, Lundstrom in midfield. Norwood came that last year and fitted in. You know, you've got a few of the others like Robinson and McBurney who are not in the team at the precise moment. But they've got a bit of strength on the strikers, which, you know, you need. And what Chrissy can do is change that. He can put Mousset in there. He's got Billy Sharp, who can score, Robinson, McBurney, and McGoldrick, everything else. So if one of them's not having a particularly good time, he can, you know, change two strikers quite easily.
A team unit and togetherness can go a long way, as you proved, and that was a massive factor in what you achieved both at Wimbledon and Sheffield United. But at some point, maybe the wider world has got to acknowledge that these are damn good footballers as well.
Oh yeah, I mean, you can see that the players are good. They've encouraged themselves. They've taken the opportunity to perform at the higher level. All right, it's 14 games. It's still to come, but there's no reason. They've shown that they're not out of place in there. I mean, for me, Lundstrom's playing better than he did last year. Fleck's playing continually well. Norwood again is the same competency. The three centre halves are settled well. Baldock's pushed on, and Stevens. And again, you know, I'm McGoldrick, you know, a free transfer has done superbly for him. I think this spirit is important. The team spirit's important. For me at Wimbledon and Sheffield United, it was vital. The team spirit was more important. It's not as easy to get team spirit, but Chris has got team spirit. He's got them all pulling in the same direction.
And he won't allow, it seems to me, any big time Charlie to come in and upset that, for the sake of getting a good player, for instance, or a very good player, to upset that chemistry.
Well, I certainly got Chris down. He wouldn't tolerate that. You know, he's not going to have somebody destroy something. You know, and you've got to make sure that the character fits in. And if not, you've got to get rid of him pretty quickly, because that can affect the team spirit and everything else. But Chris is his own man, and he's strong-willed. And I think, you know, he's going to have no nonsense in terms of anybody joining Sheffield United. It's got to fit what he wants to do. And if they don't, they're not going to survive too long.
I wonder who he learnt that from.
Well, I think, you know, you learn from a lot of different managers. I mean, Chris has come through the roots of starting off at non-league Alfreton, Halifax, Oxford, where Jim Smith was about. Good guy to have on your shoulder. He's Northampton. And I think he's learned from other people that he's worked with, other coaches. But he's his own man, you know. He's come to the table late, but he's vastly experienced, albeit not necessarily in Premier League football or anything else, but he's experienced in football, which is the same. You've still got to deal with professionals. The higher level, they're millionaires, they've got slightly different situations to players who play in League Two.
More along this theme in part two, but we've just got time in part one to take you back. This is the first slice of a video recollection of Leicester City 2, Sheffield United 5 in 1990, a promotion clinching match for Dave Bassett's Blades. And this first section is, well, it's a pre-match talk. You'll have forgotten what you said, but the most amazing thing, that in 34 seconds, there are no bleeps.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, I'm probably talking nonsense.
All right, boys, now, you don't need me to say too much today. You know what's required. Let's go out to look to win the game. We don't have to win it in the first few minutes. Be nice and sensible. Let's impose our own authority on the game. You've done it brilliantly all the season, so there's no reason why you can't go out today. irrespective of what happens, if you give me today a performance like you had the other night, with attitude, commitment and character, I'll settle for that, because that's what you've given me most of the season. OK, so let's keep our standards. That's the standard we set at West Brom on the opening day of the season. Let's take it there today. If we get the rubber, the green, we're on our...
I don't know if you recognise that guy.
Yeah, it's from here.
Yeah. And a TV followed you. I think it was a BBC Two series.
That's right, yeah. They followed United. Us from the, yeah. It worked out tremendous for them because, as certainly, I say, they didn't know promotion was going to be. They were a fly on the wall that followed us all the season. And it turned out to be a really good programme that
got good
viewing figures.
It certainly did. So will this, because in part two, we'll have more of that, more from Dave Bassett in the studio. See you in about 5 minutes. See you then.